just still where the monitor goes.
Welcome to beautiful Long Island for this year's Holiday Hoop Fest from the UBS Arena in Elmont, New York. Second game of our triple header here on Flo Hoops features an A-10 coastal matchup, Rhode Island going up against Delaware. Welcome courtside, everyone, alongside the coach, Jimmy Patsos. I'm John Brickley. So great to have you with us. Wow, what a track meet we saw in game number one. Towson falling to Bryan in double overtime. It's an interesting matchup between these two teams. Set the stage for us. What should we expect?
Look, Archie Miller has taken over a really great Rhode Island program. It's got such a history. We can go all the way, but including Danny Hurley, who just won a national championship at UConn, Jim Herrick, Tom Enders, Al Skinner. Well, he's trying to get them to compete. He's trying to get them to understand what Rhode Island basketball is about, which is going to the NCAA and winning. That's a daily task. And Archie Miller's got his way. He beat Yale, really big win. Delaware, Martin Inglesby, a Mike Bray disciple from Notre Dame, he's got the Blue Hens playing well. They beat Xavier. They beat Air Force. He just has to get this new group because in 2022, 2 years ago, he went to the NCAA. So it's kind of a Martin Inglesby and the Delaware team is going like this, and Archie Miller's in a rebuilding phase, but that's a good situation. Come here, neutral arena, and play.
Five on the season, Zeke Montgomery, Luis Courtright, Jaden House, Always Right, and Tyson Brown. The big story surrounding Rhode Island is David Fuchs, their talented freshman out of Austria, not playing for a second game because of a concussion that he suffered against College of Charlestown. So he's out for this game for Archie Miller's club. And for Delaware, Jalen Trent, Javen Riley, Niels Lane, Christian Ray. But the story here is Jair Davis, leading scorer for this team at 18 points per game. He is a playmaker, the floor general for this team.
Yeah, at 19 when they beat Xavier. That's the first win against the Big East team, okay? You think about Delaware's program with Mike Bray and all the success they've had. And Martin Inglesby, who played at Notre Dame, comes home Philadelphia native, rebuilds this thing. They win the 2022 tournament. Remember, then Nicole and the CAA, you know, you have to win your tournament to go. What I like is he's beating Air Force, but they have some other guys. Christian Ray's a jack-of-all-trades. Jalen Trent. Gerald Drumgoogle is the sixth man of the year. But Niels Lane, to me, is the guy I like because he's a transfer from Florida and he's a great defender.
Delaware gets the opening tip out of the Coastal, 7-3 on the season. Here's Trent. Off to Lane. Lane finds a triple team. Has to give it off, and a reach-in foul. Courtright called for the foul. That'll be his first. Transfer out of Quinnipiac, who played his high school ball at St. Raymond's High School. Legendary program in the city. Riley, extra pass,
yeah,
and
lot.
A travel by Lane. This is a Rhode Island team that can effectively shoot the basketball, trying to snap out of a three-game losing streak. Three of their next four opponents against those in the Coastal. Floater in the lane, and Jaden House gets Rhode Island on the board first.
Yes, that's a strong inside play. Attack the glass and get in there, get into the paint. And when you're talking about trying to compete, and you know, I know Kenny Johnson, the assistant coach, it's just a mentality Rhode Island's trying to get. I like how they start the game that way.
Davis to Ray.
He stepped out.
Turnover for Delaware. That'll be the second turnover on their first two possessions. Archie Miller, second year for him, having successful stops with Dayton, and most recently at Indiana, trying to revitalize this program.
Yeah, the
A transition from year two off of what happened in year one, where they only won nine games.
Yeah, his roster last year wasn't great. You know, he inherited a roster in the transfer portal and things like that. Last year was such an adjustment for everyone in college basketball. Good rebound, offensive rebound. That's usually trouble.
Lane lost the handle of it. It'll stay with Delaware.
And that's one of the things we talk. Austin Carroll, who's a friend of mine, his dad's John Carroll, coaches Celtics and Duquesne. And they understand. It's about getting tougher. It's about building back the Rhode Island tradition. Whether it's Tyson Wheeler to Lamar Rhodem and all the great players they've had. Well, they just had that thing going 4 years ago with Danny Hurley. And I think that's what Archie's kind of saying to himself. I didn't really talk to him, but I know his brother Sean really well. It's just we have to compete and get tougher. And when we do that, we'll be the Rhode Island Rams that not only dominated the up and down the East Coast, the East, then all of a sudden became a national program with the history they've had from Sly Williams. But that all comes with playing hard. Those are a great fan base there at Rhode Island.
Montgomery off the miss. Meanwhile, Lane got the first 2 points for Delaware. Trent, a lot of upside to his game, off glass and in. The North Dakota transfer. Averaging just under 11 points per game was huge in the victory against Xavier. And on the other end, Montgomery with the floater.
Yeah, Montgomery, how's Corey? It's interesting, the numbers are 0, 1, and 2. Those are the big three that's got to keep Rhode Island scoring consistently. That's where they ran into trouble last year, is they go through scoring droughts.
Davis missing on his first two attempts. Lane counted in the foul.
A little old-fashioned and one.
Lane, the transfer from Florida. Native of Freehold, New Jersey, played at Roselle Catholic.
Storied program.
Completes the three-point play. Early 7-4 advantage for Delaware. Second game of this triple header.
Little pressure by Delaware. Pass. A little 1-2-2 for Delaware. See if they can keep Rhode Island from running their offense.
Always Right, 5 and Blue.
Love that name, Always Right.
His brother's name is Al. That's an All Right. I'm being serious.
That's good. I like that. Make the world an interesting place.
Trent stepped on the baseline. Turnovers, an issue for Delaware in the first couple of minutes here. Already 3 turnovers committed by the Blue Hens.
Yeah, Trent is from my Baltimore native. He had 27 when they beat Xavier. He came off the bench and had 27 to beat Xavier.
Martin Inglesby, 8th season. Guiding Delaware, the team that's been on the road for 38 days. That is the road trip that the Blue Hens have, longest in Division One.
I think he just said 38 days. Is there something wrong with my headset?
38 days. He was very frank in our conversations. He says, looking back on it, we might not do that again next year.
Yeah, that's an interesting scheduling meeting. Did I miss something? We're going to go on the road for 38 days? You know, it'll make it tougher down the stretch. And by the way, sometimes those just work themselves out in year two. You know, in other words, scheduling can have a quirk every once in a while, and that's one of them.
Davis finding Riley, left wing three.
Big fan of his, Riley. I know his dad is a tremendous golfer. He went to Bishop O'Connell where Christian May went. He played at O'Connell for Joe Wooten.
Montgomery unloads a three, can't find it. Davis skies in for the rebound. Riley off the give and go. Davis, contested jumper. Looking for his first 2 points. Davis, leading scorer for the Blue Hens on the year. 18 a game, 0-for-2 to start this one. Montgomery with the right-hand finish.
See, they get downhill and go to the paint really well. House and Montgomery really get the ball downhill, get into the paint, and they'll score tough twos on you.
5 minutes in, Delaware trailing by one to Rhode Island, 8-7. Ray muscles his way in, and there are two URI players underneath for the rebound.
He's a glue guy, Swiss Army knife, whatever you want to call him. I really like him. Christian Ray does a little of everything.
Courtright inside, tried to get the feed down low.
You can tell the players are just trying to catch their breath. This has been a long stint without a timeout. And, you know, they had to warm up quick because of the double overtime. They couldn't extend the clock, so it's kind of a interesting to go, you know, five and another into the six-minute mark.
Trent forces one off the backboard. Tyson Brown getting his first minutes of action for Archie Miller.
Yeah, long stint again. Just got to keep playing. You got to finish ahead. If you're Ray.
Ray.
Another missed layup.
Can't complete the layup. You can just tell both teams are gassed right now looking for a timeout.
Yeah, because they used to play in four-minute stints. They had to go really hard in warm-ups because they had to get loose quickly. I like Riley reading the screen there. See what he does here.
Lane.
Nice cut
to a cutting Ray.
Yes. Yep, reached in.
Foul that's going to go against Trent. Takes us to our first timeout. Delaware, Rhode Island, second game of our triple header here on Flo Hoops of the Holiday Hoop Fest. Delaware out to a one-point lead. Early action from Long Island, Delaware, Rhode Island. 1 point difference between the two, just about 7 minutes into this first half. Here's a look at the tail of the tape. Primarily throughout, both these teams are trying to find their adjustments this year. I mean, think about it from Delaware's perspective. A year ago, they went 17-16. They were below 500 in conference play, just 2 years removed from an NCAA tournament bid.
Yeah, I mean, they're gonna have some new players. They're going to get some transfers taken from them. And when the ball goes in from outside, you know, you look like a better program. That's kind of what both these teams, I would say sharp shooting from the three-point line is not their strength. But I think this is a really great regional matchup. I mean, I give Rick Giles a lot of credit for that because he had to put together some interesting matchups. This is the next step up. Really, you know, Delaware, Rhode Island, two state schools. I like the matchup.
Courtright with just his 7-3 of the season puts Rhode Island in front 11-9.
And he was going to be featured if we did the player of the game. Sorry, we had a double overtime game, so we couldn't do that. He's the guy that Quinnipiac played Rhode Island, and they noticed how good they were. Quinnipiac beat Rhode Island. He played well. That's what I'm saying about the modern era. You know what I mean, Johnny? He plays well, and they're like telling him to transfer in the handshake line.
We don't need to talk about handshake lines, Coach.
I always change names.
Meanwhile, Rhode Island, you know, a team that under Archie Miller looking to flourish in year number two. Three from the corner, that one off the mark by Estevez, making his first appearance. Think about this, Dan Hurley won six more games in year number two.
Yeah, the A-10, you can't climb as quickly as you can in other conferences just because you have, look, UMass hired Frank Martin. He went to the Final Four with South Carolina. Archie Miller's a known commodity. He's done really well at Dayton, okay, Indiana. He had a lot of success there, too. That was, you know, he just left at the end, but he had a lot of success there, went to the NCAA. There's other coaches in the league. Chris Caputo's a new coach at GW from Miami, assistant to NFL. You're not just going to roll up the A-10 by hiring one new coach. It's just, it takes a little while to get players, to instill what you want, to get the fans behind you, and then to get the thing rolling again. They've always had a ton of success in Philadelphia and New York recruiting. That's where Rhode Island has always had its bread and butter.
Meanwhile, Wright with that three, his fourth made three of the season. Hauser off the bench for Delaware gets his first chance. Right to Estevez, quick fire three, way off the mark. Estevez, a native of Harlem, coming close to home in his return here at the Holiday Hoop Fest. Hauser misses on the 12-foot jumper. Cartwright there for the rebound. Already four rebounds for Louis Cartwright. Montgomery forcing his way in the paint.
Yeah, I like when he drives the ball. That's all right. That's a good play. Now you got to sprint all the way back to the paint, stop the ball in transition.
Kobe Jerome, 11 in white. Drumgooley also off the bench. Hauser calling for it. Cross-court pass. Misfire on the three.
Clearly he's a big guy, Hauser, but he must be able to shoot threes because they're running basically plays for him to get open threes on the perimeter.
He's 61% from beyond the arc.
Yeah, it's early in the season.
Fomina with his first points of the game.
You can't block a shot because he's a big guy. And I cover the NBA. We see where the bigger and bigger men are taking threes, but that's a nice move.
Drumgooley parting the sea. Transfer from Albany coming in, averaging over 12 a game. Gets Delaware back within three. Cartwright with a contested three that rimmed in and out. Good frenetic pace to this first half between
these
two teams.
Yes, I like this pace.
Drumgooley for three.
Tough.
First made three of the game for Delaware. Ties it up at 16. Cartwright, as Fomina can't get the jumper to drop, out of bounds. It'll be Delaware possession when we return. Timeout on the floor, three-point shooting has been a key storyline thus far. Cartwright answered on the other floor by Drumgooley, and we find ourselves tied at 16. Rhode Island and Delaware tied up at 16 apiece. Mentioned earlier that this Delaware program is on the longest Division I road trip this season, 38 days. Their eighth straight game away from home. You've got to go all the way back to November 12th, the last time they played on their home floor. That's a schedule. That puts Road Warriors into a whole new meaning.
Yes, that's Mel Gibson, Road Warriors 1-2, Mad Max, the Thunderdome. That's a whole other season. What I was saying before is maybe it equals out. Maybe next year you get a lot of home games. You know, maybe there was a scheduling quirk. All right, they had to go to a tournament, but which they did do. They were down in the Bahamas with GW, which is a beautiful place to be if you're going to be away. They're at the Bahamar for three games. But that is a ton of, that is a long day. Because you can play one Division III these days. Nice move.
Davis, out of the timeout, gets his first 2 points. Leading scorer for this Delaware team at over 18 a game. Estevez quickly on the other side gets fouled.
He's tough. I like Estevez. He's got that tough New York game. What I was going to say is, but if you have to go to the Bahamar tournament, where they played three games, it's a beautiful resort. And Nicole Smithsbury next door for the record. Right next door. You can go see her grave. But it's to play three games, and if that's what you have to do to go to on a beautiful trip to a beautiful resort for your players, then you stay on the road for that long. What I don't understand is you can play a Division III team these days. Back when I coached, you couldn't play one. Now you can, so you slip one in if you have to have a home game, but it'll work itself out. They're 7-3. Maybe they're better on the road.
Estevez knocks down the free throw. That has been a issue this year for Rhode Island. They are second to last in the country in free throw shooting at 58% this season.
Yeah, they play a lot of games at home, but I said they had a big win over Yale in my, you know, I'm out there and I'm watching a lot of different games. Yale's picked to win by most prognosticators to win the Ivy League. They went to the NCAA two of the last 3 years. They went to the NIT last year. That was a big win for Rhode Island to beat Yale. They just have to kind of inch by inch back to not shoot free throws well at home. Sometimes that can just be a mental thing because you're shooting with your background where you basically practice every day. They are building a brand new practice facility in Rhode Island. It's beautiful, too.
Drumgooley at the free throw line. Spent two seasons at Pitt. Went to Albany for 2 years and has had some early success, I should say, for the Blue Hens. Go back to that game against UNC Greensboro where they put up 22 points, a season high.
Yeah, and UNC Greensboro, a really good team, a really tough team. Greensboro, they're top their league right now as well.
That's
the man, got a curl cut there. Nice play.
Great cut on the play, ending with Brandon Weston making his first appearance, the Brooklyn native who, because of personal reasons, did not play in that last game against College of Charleston.
He was at Seton Hall prior to being at Rhode Island.
And you know, Coach, a lot of great people have come from Seton Hall.
Including my partner, my broadcast partner, one of the finest.
A lot of famous people have come from that institution. Estevez at the point, off the mismatch with Davis. Three off the mark. Brown trying to corral the offensive rebound into the hands of Estevez with the left hand
finish.
Yes,
Estevez says, give me minutes, Coach. I'll show you what I can do. Taking it to the rack.
Davis, step back jumper. Right, forces it up right back into his own hands. Weston, contested three. As Davis with the rebound.
That was a little off the mark there by Kobe Jerome.
Weston tried to find an open Rory Stewart, instead intercepted on the pass. Delaware a chance to tie or take the lead on this possession. Jerome,
nice
no
pass.
Look pass. Up and under. Estevez pushing pace up.
Estevez likes to get into the paint. I like him. He's very comfortable in there.
And a timeout on the floor. Mentioned before, in a frenetic pace to this first half, Rhode Island up by two. Second matchup of our Holiday Hoop Fest inside UBS Arena here in Elmont, New York. Rhode Island, a two-point lead on Delaware. John Brickley, Jimmy Patsos back with you. And talking about this Rhode Island team that still looking for their first road win of the season. You've got to go all the way back to January 15th of 2022, the last time they picked up a win away from the Ryan Center.
Yeah, and that's what we're talking about. It's just, it's not typical Rhode Island, and that's what happens. Sometimes you have a coaching change, and Archie Miller's done this before, and he went to Dayton where he built a powerhouse for the, it's a high major league back then. The A-10 was getting 3-4 teams in the NCAA. But he knew it was going to take a little while. You know, they get to play Providence every year, which is a great game. But the A-10's really good. But Providence has overtaken Rhode Island a little bit in the fan base up there. Archie Miller is the guy that's going to fight back. He's not going to overwhelm you with his personality and run around like that, but he's going to do it methodically. He's going to get his own players. He's a tremendous X and O basketball coach. You just got to be patient. You and I talked about how there's not a lot of patience out there right now, so we hope Rhode Island's patient with Archie.
Trying to work it inside to Davis. Curled his way around
wow,
and finishes
move.
With the made bucket. Davis, who was the CAA Rookie of the Year back in 2022. Great prominence coming out of the state of Delaware. Davis hit the deck hard, and possession goes to the Blue Hens. I mean, Archie Miller even said this week about Delaware that they're a team that's a very deceptive one because of their age. You're not playing against boys on the court. You're playing against men.
And he's correct. And look, there's one more year of this in basketball. That's how it's going to be. This nice move.
Davis off glass it in, and he'll have a chance at the three-point play.
And Jair Davis, that's a quick bounce move. Once again, he's basically playing four or five. Him and Ray are the four and five men. Both versatile. Both can switch three and D. But Davis can finish, and that's why he beat Xavier. The thing about the COVID year is, whether it was right or wrong, is irrelevant of what I think. Guys are getting fifth years and sixth years now. Guys, that has one more year of that, and then that's gone. I don't mind the one-time transfer rule. I like the NIL. Players deserve to get paid. How much is not up to me. 2-1-2 pressure there by Delaware. I like that just to keep, it's not really to steal the ball, it's just to keep them from running their offense, but in this one more year of seeing 25 and 26-year-olds play basketball. That's just the way it is right now, and you have to adjust to it. Delaware's done a great job adjusting to it. Graduate school right on 95, great facilities. They got a G League team playing for there.
Three-point shot by Riley. He set the Delaware freshman record a year ago in three-point shooting at over 45%, and he connects on his first three of the game.
I've known Kevin a long time. I'm almost have a bias into his dad's a really good guy. Terry Riley's a great guy. Kevin was at O'Connell High School in D.C., played for D.C. Premier in the summer. He's not just a catch-and-shoot shooter, but make no mistake, that's what he does best.
Stolen away. Nice job by Lane on the fast break, turning defense into offense, heading to the free throw line.
Nice fan base from Delaware drove up from the 302 area code. I was wondering, I see a lot of 302 around here. I like that. Go down to Dewey. Go to the Starboard this summer. That's a great place to go in Delaware, too.
Well, Delaware's been able to turn things around. 8-0 run after a slow start that was a combination of just missed opportunities and turnovers as Lane heads to the free throw line. Just a 59% free throw shooter on the season.
Thanks, Dad.
Lane, who, as mentioned before, went to Roselle Catholic, won a state title in 2019. But if you go all the way back to his time in middle school, how about this? He was a nationally ranked fencer.
I saw that in my game notes earlier. I just wasn't sure if it was him. En garde.
That's a sport I could see you picking up.
Yeah, I mean, at my young age, there were probably like no swords for him. But it's just... it's a unique thing, but you know what? He kind of moves. He's got that. He's got a. He moves very fluidly. I like that. But that was the most interesting thing. And I'd like to hear the story of how he got involved in that.
7 points and 11 minutes of action for Lane on the floor for Delaware, who has used a 10-0 run to stretch this lead out to six.
Yeah, Delaware, they did well coming out of that timeout. Now, last 4 minutes, critical what's going into the half. I like that post. Catch that with two hands.
Weston. One-on-one with Davis, lost that battle.
Yeah, I like that. No call on the foul. Let him play. I mean, fencing's a pretty, there's sailing, there's squash, there's different type of sports. Fencing's a pretty limited, you know, you don't grow up around and just go fencing. I really want to hear that story about how that happened. What an awesome thing. What an awesome story.
Trent, dribble drive and a foul at the end of the play. Second personal against Weston. Trent to the line, and Jalen Trent, native of Baltimore, a transfer from North Dakota.
Summit League, really good league out there.
I thought it was interesting what Martin Inglesby had to say about Trent coming into the fold for Delaware. He made the point of saying that that role of having a fifth-year guard, probably the most important role to fill in recruiting. And you get a guy that's a system-type player. He's a post-up-type guard. A unique offensive player.
And with a lot of experience, as you just said, there's more. That's just a fifth-year guard. The Summit League, that's where Oral Roberts rolled to the Sweet 16, hello. Mm-hmm. Like, that's a really good league. South Dakota State's done well. I know North Dakota's more focuses on hockey. We know that. They have a palatial palace they play in. But you're in that league. Well, he comes here, goes to Delaware, but you know, basketball school. But it's experience, and as you said, it's a little different having a post-up guard. Anybody who's played in Baltimore, you know, I have an affinity for that. That means you're tough.
Montgomery, Davis might have gotten a piece of that. Out of bounds, possession of the Blue Hens.
That was quite a four-minute run there for Delaware.
12-0 run over the last 2:35 for the Delaware Blue Hens. 32-24 on top of URI. 3:51 left to play in the first half of this Holiday Hoop Fest. Delaware, thanks to a 12-0 run, has built up an 8-point lead. And Martin Inglesby, who played at Notre Dame, was an assistant under head coach Mike Bray, eighth season guiding this Delaware team. And he certainly has been one of those difference makers in terms of what he's been able to bring to this program. Just recently, a conference championship with an NCAA tournament bid. It's how do you get to that next level, especially with this program moving to Conference USA in 2 years.
And that, it's a great secret. Thank you for that. That's big time that you do that, because that's all about football, as we know.
Riley,
the only problem I have with that move is the travel. I hope you're going to charter some. That's a charge.
They got a blocking foul that's going to go against Riley.
That's interesting.
Or check that against Ray. But it's true, this day and age in college sports.
Look, football drives
Cincinnati.
The bus.
Cincinnati's in the Big 12.
Football drives the bus. And people forget, you know, college basketball for March Madness, et cetera. But, you know, these decisions, all these conference decisions, Gary Williams yelled at me. He always yelled at me. One time he deserved it. But Gary Williams, you know, I brought up like Duke and Kansas. Think about Duke and Kansas. The programs, the schools.
Down to one. Estevez.
Oh, I thought it.
And a shot clock violation. That is now going to be, by the way, the seventh turnover for Rhode Island.
Yeah, that's one of the things. See, when they got good possessions by getting into the paint. Delaware moving to that Conference USA for football. It's more travel. Yeah, but that's all. My point before was no one asked Duke basketball and Kansas basketball. You can't get better than those two programs what they thought about conference realignment. These are football decisions that are being made.
Montgomery, lob ahead.
Martin Inglesby will adjust. He'll adjust. Nice play.
Davis, nice bounce pass off the feed from Ray.
I really like Christian Ray. He is a jack of all trades. I did a little homework, but I got some inside intel from people. He really does scraps, plays tough, defends, can pass, shoot. He's like a little MVP without the numbers, you know?
Two teams right now going in opposite directions. Delaware's on a 14-0 run. Rhode Island still looking for points in over 4 minutes. Jump ball situations, that's going to stay with Rhode Island.
It's going to stay here. But it was interesting what you said. Martin Inglesby is as good a guy. I would have my son play for him, that's for sure. Martin Inglesby, I've known him from Notre Dame. He's mild-mannered, but he's once you get to know him, he's really nice guy. But he's really good basketball coach. But he has the lens of a point guard that played on really successful teams at Notre Dame. And that was part of the coaching staff of Pat Connaughton and those teams going to the Elite Eight. So I was impressed that Delaware kept him, because I thought after he won, he might leave and go to a higher level.
Offensive foul, they're going to call that against Fomina. Goes the other way, that's the eighth turnover for Rhode Island.
Yeah, Rhode Island's in danger here with 2 minutes to go. It's a 10-point game right now. You want it to go, you know, you'd like to get that to single digits.
Off the high screen, Riley. Cross-court pass from Gooley. Nine on the shot clock, forces it up into the hands of Wright. Estevez touched the line out of bounds.
Those little things, catch that ball with two hands.
Rhode Island with six turnovers, Coach, over the last 5+ minutes.
Yeah, that's why they're not scoring. Catch that with two hands, and Estevez, good attack on the glass. Go cut it to eight. Instead, they're going to have trouble keeping this thing under. Now, you don't want it to get. I've seen the other night I did a Wizards game. It was a 2-point game with a minute to go. They went to halftime down 10. That's the danger Rhode Island has right now, because Delaware's going to run their offense.
It's a 14-0 run for Delaware. Riley, extra pass. Drum Gooley sees the lane, and a foul by Rhode Island. Gooley's going to be to the line, 7 points, just in 9 minutes on the floor. was actually considered, how about this, a high major D1 football prospect back in high school until he solely focused on it his junior year of high school. I mean, he's a relative, in fact, of former NFL cornerback Dominique Rodgers-Cromartie.
Yes, exactly. Good intel. You know, that's why you talked about should guys in the previous broadcast switch to one sport. Sometimes I think they might leave one of their other sports too early.
Estevez trying to work it. High-low game intercepted. Taken away by Trent. Drumgooley.
If that had gone, that was a pass barely got through. Shot fake shot with a guy flying at you. That was a degree of difficulty. It was a little high.
Rhode Island needs an answer. They have gone almost 6 minutes without a point, while Delaware has trended the other way, a 15-0 run.
I got to tell you, I don't think that Delaware is really taking advantage of the drought.
Down to six for Courtright.
And see, there
and
it
that
is.
One finally Cuts ends the drought for the Rams. 7 points for Courtright. And a timeout on the floor here with 21.4 left to go in this first half. Rhode Island, 7 turnovers over the last 6-plus minutes. This play by Courtright ending the drought of over 5 minutes without any points. The Quinnipiac transfer, who, as Coach mentioned earlier, knocked off Rhode Island in the season opener last year, and now has become the primary ball handler this season for Archie Miller. Seven players have scored for Delaware, led by Davis, who, despite a slow start to the game, has 9 points on 4 of 7 shooting. Drumgooley has 8. Lane, who's on the bench, with 7. And Delaware can hold for the final possession of this first half. Down to 8, Trent. Looking on the wing, finds Hauser in the low post. Hauser waved the basket off. Traveling violation, so Rhode Island will have it with 2.1. And the timeout taken by Archie Miller. A Rhode Island team that has committed 11 turnovers in this first half, just one away from their season average. And yet they own a +7 advantage in rebounding here today. Both teams shooting over 35%. Delaware has been in the line 9 out of 10 times compared to Rhode Island, 4 of 4 from the free throw line. Be right to inbound for Rhode Island. 2.1 left to go in this first half. To Estevez. Estevez at the buzzer. Does not fall. That's how the first half comes to a close. Delaware uses a 15-2 run to close it out, leading 35-26 on Rhode Island here at the break. Martin Inglesby, head coach for Delaware, standing by with Jimmy Patsos, has to be pleased with Delaware's production in the first half.
Coach Inglesby, you held them scoreless for 6 minutes there, and then you made your own run. Talk about the run you made there to finish the half.
Yeah, I mean, we were getting stops on the defensive end. I think our toughness and physicality, being able to switch some stuff and keep bodies in front of bodies, really helped us when we were down, be able to get a lead in return.
You have a lot of different ways you can go. You got a lot of depth. You got a big guy that shoots threes. You're a very interesting team. Tell us about that.
Yeah, we're versatile. I mean, we got some guys that can score. We got a point guard that plays inside. He likes to post up. We got some guys, big guys that can step out and shoot the basketball. But, you know, really proud of our defense. Only hold them to 26 points.
You got nice fans here, too. You're a point guard. He probably wanted to post up. Great job. Big second half. What do you think you're going to tell them at halftime?
We got to get back in transition. I think that was how they got confident on the offensive end. The first 4 minutes, really important for us to be able to stay poised and control the tempo, but obviously like where we are.
Thanks for the time.
All right, Jimmy, thanks.
John, back to you.
Jimmy, thanks so much. Delaware, thanks to a 15-2 run, slowing down Rhode Island's offense, committing seven turnovers in over 6.5 minutes. We are at the half here on Flo Hoops. Back inside UBS Arena, the 2023 Holiday Hoop Fest at We Are the Half here on Flo Hoops. Hi, everyone. Back courtside, John Brickley. Pleased to be joined now by the president of the Gazelle Group, that being one, Rick Giles. Rick, great to have you with us here today. It certainly is one of those times where reality and preparation meet. It's been a long journey to get to this point, but how do you feel about the event today with this triple header?
Yeah, so we're really excited to be at UBS and have this triple header. We started last year with one game, and our goal was to do more than that this year, so we're excited to have these three matchups. We plan on expanding it into the future. We think this is a great venue for basketball. It's a chance for teams to come during the holiday season, spend a little bit of time in the New York area, as well as get great competition.
There's a lot of great competition, to your point, all around the East Coast, from Pennsylvania, Rhode Island, New York, here at this tournament. This is just one of many tournaments, though, that Gazelle Group has their fingerprint on. What does the calendar look ahead to when we turn the page to 2024?
Yeah, so we start in early November each year. We spend most of the year planning for these 2 months, November and December, and we usually do a series of neutral site events. what are called multiple team events with the NCAA. So we this past year, have been at the Garden and Barclays Center already. We'll be at UBS today. We'll be at Prudential Center next week. We've also been in Daytona Beach in November, and we've done four home events, Duke, Kentucky, Nebraska, and Cal Baptist. So we've had a really, really full calendar, and we look to sort of repeat that calendar next year, as well as maybe add a few more interesting neutral site matchups.
Well, when you talk about some great sites that you've been on, whether it be at Madison Square Garden here at UBS Arena, some notable programs, Kentucky, North Carolina, UConn come to mind. What do you make of the way that the Gazelle Group has their fingerprint on college basketball in a variety of ways?
Yeah. So I think one of the things that we've been able to do over the years, and probably one of our strengths, is that we've been able to adapt to a changing environment. So the college sports landscape has changed a lot over the last few years, and going back 20 years, and college basketball landscape has changed as well. So what we've tried to do is identify what teams want. So we have different types of events, different levels of competition between whether it's a four-team event, a single game, you know, each team playing one game today in a triple header, or home events. So the landscape's going to continue to evolve. I think teams want to find good competition. They want to find good competition on a neutral floor. It gets harder and harder to do home and homes. So games like this today at UBS and at some of the other neutral venues that we play in become more meaningful. With the NCAA's net, those metrics are really hard to sort of figure out, and people are always chasing those numbers because a slight move in the metrics makes a big difference on Selection Sunday.
Great amount of excitement on the horizon here in college basketball. We'll be back with much more as halftime continues here on Flo Hoops. You're watching Flo Hoops as we're inside UBS Arena, halftime continuing on of the 2023 Holiday Hoop Fest. The president of the Gazelle Group, Rick Giles, joining us here. And Rick, let's talk about the future of college basketball encompassing the Gazelle Group. What can we look forward to?
So we've got this event today, we've got another one next week, and then we've actually got a hockey event in Milwaukee at the end of December, between Christmas and New Year's. And then we go right into starting to plan for our postseason event, which is the CBI, the College Basketball Invitation. So we started that about 15 years ago, and it was when the NCAA decided to reduce the field of the NIT and have automatic qualifiers. And that meant right away that there were going to be anywhere from like 15 to 20 teams that previously were playing in the postseason that weren't going to be able to play under these new rules. So we came up with the idea of creating a 16-team tournament, and we wanted it to be a little bit different in those early days. So we played single elimination at home sites until we got to the final two teams. And then for the first time in sort of college basketball history, we had a finals series. And we had a best of three, with the higher seeded team getting two home games and the lower seeded team getting one home game. And what we found was as teams advanced, they got over the boy we got left out of the NCAA or NIT mentality. And as they advanced and as they won, the interest level picked up and the excitement and the buy-in picked up, so that by the time we got to the finals, it was really a true postseason home environment, which you really don't have in college basketball, because all the postseason conference tournaments are at neutral sites, and of course the NCAA at a neutral site, and the NIT championship back then also at a neutral site. So these teams were playing for a championship, and the kids, the players, it was really exciting to see them because they felt like they were in the NBA. They felt like they were in the finals.
I was just going to say, what has been the feedback? Because I understand from a player's perspective, they get to play another game, check that off the box. But in terms of what you're talking about in terms of the bigger picture, it's got to be great from a coach's standpoint.
So teams love to get the extra practice in. It's sort of, you know, we don't kid ourselves. It's not the national championship. It's a chance to play in a postseason tournament, to win a postseason championship, and then, you know, develop your team for next year. So we had to get away from the home team sites during COVID. We actually, we did a early season bubble with our early season tournaments, we ended up doing a postseason bubble as well, and we did it down in Daytona Beach. That first year we invited 8 teams. We weren't sure if anybody was going to want to come, and we actually found out that that was a great venue and a great opportunity for teams to converge in one location. So that was the year that we changed the format, and we've been at Daytona Beach ever since. Now we have the full 16 team field coming, and it really is like a spring break trip for the teams. It's a chance for them to reward all of the teams that play have had great seasons. They might have lost deep in their conference tournament, but we've had great participation and great interest. They like to bring their teams down. They have an off day. They can spend the time on the beach. So it's a good team building experience for the following year.
Adding another layer to March Madness, yes, which all college basketball fans loves. Rick, great to see you.
Thanks,
Rick Giles, the president of the Gazelle Group, joining us here at the half. We'll be back in just a moment. About to start off the second half here at UBS Arena inside what has been a interesting first half of the Holiday Hoop Fest, game number 2 between Rhode Island and Delaware. And Delaware, Jimmy, a team that ended that first half on a 15-2 run.
You know, you heard Coach Inglesby, the first thing was, we're playing better D. That turns into scores for us. But I also think their offensive prowess is a little better. They have a little more balanced scoring. They had a little more experienced team, but Delaware now has to weather the first 4 minutes because you know Coach Miller talked to his team about competing, about what we're trying to do, and they got to get the ball in the paint.
Take a look at the first half stats. Rhode Island held to just under 36% shooting. Did have a plus 7 in rebounding, but the turnovers were the big problem. They went over 6.5 minutes without any points, committing 7 turnovers.
Yeah, they couldn't really make any threes either, but 11 turnovers is not going to do it in a half. You can't go through scoring droughts like that. I actually felt Delaware had some good looks that they didn't put them away. But it's going to be interesting to see what Coach Miller comes up with. They're having a meeting right now. He is going over. He is very going. He's going over some plays. He's going over about competing and playing hard and playing with pride. I could hear him from over here in the huddle. He was not happy with the way that situation went to end the half.
Rhode Island shot 35% in that first half. Their leading scorer was Courtright at 7 points. Meanwhile, Davis was the number one scorer, 9 points as the second half underway. Delaware looking to build upon a 7-3 record coming in. Worked it down to Davis.
Yeah, that's a silly turnover. Davis, I just want to see him go up and shoot that.
Brown, uncontested, lost the handle of it. Turnover number 12, so both these teams start off their first possession of the second half with a turnover. Davis cross-court pass to Riley. Free throw line
short.
That's
a tough shot.
Back into the hands of Lane. Shot clock did not reset. Trent post up, and that's what he did so well at North Dakota. And that was one of the reasons why that was such a key play for Delaware to get him in the offseason.
Yeah, post-up guard. Look, Jalen Brunson of the Knicks right down the street, he does a lot of work in the paint. Guys have different ways to score. I like Trent's footwork in there. Probably played center growing up.
By the way, did you hear Tom Thibodeau, the Knicks head coach, after Brunson put down the career-high 50? He goes, he scored as many in one game as his old man did in his career.
That's great. His old man who played at Temple from Salem, Massachusetts.
There's Wright at the point. Bounce pass inside. Brown lost the handle of it. Nearly taken away. It'll
yeah,
stay
a little sloppy start
Delaware.
Here in the second half for both teams. Much like the start of the game. That was the thing. See, the start of the game was a little ragged because, you know, they're sitting in the locker room waiting for a double overtime game to get over. But Delaware did a better job of snapping out of it.
Trent.
It's a tough pass.
Riley had to save it out of bounds, and that leads it to a wide open Wright, who's going to finish with a two-handed flush.
If you can't save it towards your basket, don't save it.
Davis with 8 on the shot clock. Brown in his face. Lane. Riley, corner 3.
That's good defense by Rhode Island. See, they're getting stops. Now an attack in transition. See if they can stop me. They're from Rhode Island.
That one over the backboard.
They want
to
keep attacking.
Delaware.
If I'm Rhode Island, I keep getting into that paint. Because both Montgomery and House I like, but I like them better when they're going downhill.
Delaware 5 straight wins to begin the season, followed it by 3 straight losses, and now looking for their 3rd straight win coming off the victory against Robert Morris.
There goes Trent in his post position.
Trent.
Man, couldn't find anybody. They kind of double-teamed him there. You got to find a place. Somebody has to come down to the wing to get open so you can pass it to him. Yep.
Offensive foul. Wave the basket off. Your point, Coach, about sloppy play, that is five combined turnovers in the first 3.5 minutes of the second half.
Yeah, each the start of each half of the game, they will not be putting in the Naismith Hall of Fame here because there's a lot of turnovers and some funky plays like saving the ball on your own end. Archie Miller, he's just trying to find a way to get his team. They seem a little out of sync, you know, just in terms of what they're trying to do.
Davis from the elbow.
Nice shot. See, Riley, nice play. Gets into the paint. Easy pass. Davis off the catch. That's what I'm saying. I want to see, like, Rhode Island kind of run some sets to where they get what they want.
Davis now in a double figures. First player for either team. 11 points, 5 of 8 shooting.
Oh,
anticipation. Trent with the steal. Leads to a layup. 14 turnovers in this game for Rhode Island.
Yeah, Delaware's got it going defense. See, they're switching the screen and roll and overplaying to the throwback man on that play.
And this has been the story. 14 turnovers, 13 points off those turnovers. Why Delaware has the lead.
Yeah, Ray playing good defense. See, they're not letting him make. They're stopping the drive without giving him easy passes.
Nice look. Could not capitalize. Brown off the pass from Courtright.
Oh, tough turnover there. Convert here if you're Rhode Island. You just got to convert that.
Courtright, no. Brown with
nice.
The follow.
Good effort.
Tyson Brown out of Virginia Beach. Cuts it down to 11. 41-30. Delaware in front. Game number two of this Holiday Hoop Fest. Wide open is Davis for three.
This is too open. I mean, this is a guy who's your best player. He was going to be our featured player. He had 19 when they beat Xavier. I know the Rhode Island staff has talked ad nauseum about stopping him. You just can't leave him that open on the perimeter to catch and shoot the ball like that.
If you talk to his head coach, he'll tell you that Davis is a next-level scorer. But more importantly, is take ownership of this team. That was one thing the coaching staff wanted from Jari Davis to the start of the season. Down to five for URI. Courtright dribbles through traffic and a left-hand finish.
A tough drive. I like that. Get to the paint and finish.
Out of bounds, and that leads us to a timeout. Turnovers, the story so far in the second half. Davis, though, heating up for Delaware. Just over 6 minutes into this second half, and Delaware has stretched it out to a double-digit lead, 44-32. You look at Rhode Island, obviously this is a team that is trying to build off a 9-win season from a year ago. Again, they've got one of the oldest teams in the country. They're shooting the ball better. But what has to happen, Coach, from your perspective, to make that progression from year one to year two in the right direction?
You know, you can never, I'll tell you one thing, you can never stop recruiting, you can never stop teaching. And then sometimes it's finding out which five work well together. In the prior game, I thought Phil Martelli Jr. did a fantastic job. We don't have to play a big guy against a really big Towson team. But he had five guys, basically five guards. Yep, that went off. Yeah, that's lazy on the inbounds play. So, in other words, what makes the progression year one, year two, playing hard, competing, recruiting, but also what makes the change? Older guys and grad transfers, but finding out how you want to play. But if you have to play small, if that's your best five, you go with it.
Right. Nice look down low to find an open Weston. Quiet 4 points from Weston in his return. Missed the game against College of Charleston because of personal reasons. Keep in mind, too, David Fuchs, their talented freshman, out for his second straight game.
Yeah, concussion.
Due to concussion protocol.
Concussion, right?
He didn't even practice, by the way. As Davis is unloading in this second half, make it 17 points. Jari Davis, eight of them coming in this second half. Estevez, high off the glass and in.
Yeah, this is my guy Estevez. I like the way he played. He's come in and just home trip to New York, laying it all out there, takes it to the glass hard.
Kobe Jerome to Davis. Same spot.
You gotta
same
guard
result.
That guy. You have to guard him on the perimeter if you're at Island. I don't. That seems to be lost in translation of finding him, especially off the catch. You got to get him off the line and don't let him shoot off the catch.
Delaware's number one scorer already has 20. Estevez with a three. He's got the last five for Rhode Island. And a timeout taken on the floor. What a change of events. Both teams on fire, but it's Delaware up by 11 with a timeout on the floor. To 39, our score, Delaware in front of Rhode Island. And for Rhode Island, they're just trying to find victories away from the Ryan Center. 0-4 on the road and on neutral slates as well. And you can see, look at just the difference in terms of what their scoring average is compared to what they're giving up home versus road.
Yeah, and they played some tough teams. Look, Northwestern, they lost to Northwestern who beat Purdue. They lost to Washington State, who's Kyle's doing a really good job out there right now. They're top the Pac-12. The last year, sadly, of the Pac-12, Washington State's having a really good. But to play in a neutral site game against a coastal CAA team, I expected this one to be a little closer. So I'm interested to see what Rhodey does here coming out of the timeout.
Each team has knocked down their last five attempts. Hauser, step back, corner three, back ironed it. Offensive rebound, Lane, as Jerome corrals it out. Drumgooley has to give it off. Hauser with seven on the shot clock. Drumgooley, no. Another offensive rebound. Hauser, that one blocked away.
Good pass.
Open for three, Lane.
Can't do better than that.
That entire possession comes up with nothing for Delaware.
No, good. Inside, outside, good-looking threes.
Estevez, he's got the last seven for Rhode Island, has cut it down to single digits.
You know, you start to look at Rhode Island's stats, and you got to wonder with Estevez, when's he going to be a full-time starter? Because he's really bringing it. I love
Delaware.
His energy.
Heading to the free throw line when we come back. Another timeout on the floor for the Holiday Hoop Fest here in Long Island. Rhode Island making a charge in the form of Cam Estevez, who's put together a 7-0 run. But prior to his run, Delaware's Jari Davis just was lighting it up from all aspects of the court.
Big fan of his. Love the way he plays the game. But if you're Rhode Island, you just can't let him get that many looks right now. You just have to stop that. And I'm sure Archie and his staff are talking about that over there in the huddle right now. Can't let Davis beat us. And Estevez is trying to show them the way. You got to finish, get in there, finish strong, and then go down and get some stops. But you got to continue to finish strong if you're Rhode Island at the basket.
Jari Davis with his fifth 20-point game of the season, 16th of his career, just eight shy of his career high. As Drumgooley, who was fouled prior to the timeout, a chance to extend this lead, a 74% free throw shooter.
Makes him.
America East guy in terms of playing for Albany for 2 years.
But he was at Pittsburgh as well.
He was effective in his time at Albany just last year. Finished second in the America East in points per game. Back up to a double-digit lead for the Blue Hens. Weston.
Yeah, has hands on him. Yep, going to drive the ball. Shorten the game. Archie knows what he's doing there. Now that's only the first personal foul, so they're not coming close to the bonus yet. But Archie wants to drive the ball to see if they can stop Coach Miller.
That foul, the third on Lane.
Good pass.
Nice no-look pass to Stewart off the feed from Fomita. Just the 7 assists of the season for the redshirt freshman out of Montreal, Quebec. Here's Davis. Short.
Good defense, didn't foul. Fumina contested shot, didn't foul.
Oh, now Davis tough. With the steal. And the two-handed flush for Jari Davis.
See, I don't mind Brandon Weston turning the ball over, but I might have sprinted back on D since he's the one that turned it over.
Jair Davis, 22 points to lead all scores.
Oh, he has answered. He has lived up to expectations.
Jair Davis certainly plays like he's on a next level.
What I like about him is he doesn't really care what size he is. In other words, he'll shoot jumpers at 6'7", he'll go inside. I talked to Martin Inglesby about that. I kind of snuck in my third question, much to Schrato's chagrin. But he has a versatile team that can do a lot of things and play a lot of different ways. And Davis fits the mold. Like, he's big, he can rebound, he can, obviously he's one of the bigger guys on the court, but he shoots threes off the catches. And then you have him post up guard like Trent. In other words, that goes right into what I'm saying. That's what Martin Inglesby was saying to me at halftime. We have a flexible, versatile, very interesting team because everybody can do a little of everything. That's just a nice steal.
Delaware as a team tonight, 10 steals. But again, it's been the points off turnovers. They've been able to force Rhode Island into 15 turnovers and turn those into 15 points.
Well, what's going to happen here with the Delaware situation is if they keep getting stops and then points to turnovers, how does Rhode Island score enough points to come back? That's when I'm kind of watching this as a, you know, as an announcer, but as I'm coaching, I'm watching both coaches and their teams. I don't know if Rhode Island has enough firepower here. They might have to start pressing just to get some movement because Delaware comes out with a little press here just to slow them down, a little 1-2-2.
Yeah, that's
working hard at the top.
Has been the only playmaker. He's the only player in double figures for Rhode Island. 13 points. Courtright kind of been held in check, just 7. Again, they're not playing with Fuchs out because of the concussion. Fight for it. Davis quickly ahead. Numbers the other way for Delaware.
Yeah, Fred. He's going to finish that. Ooh. And there's Ray
with
Mr.
the follow-up.
Doing all everything. He just does a little of everything and continues to... Jack of all, he scores inside. He plays good post defense. He doesn't ever overexert himself to the wrong position. Doesn't try to do too much. Big fan of Ray's.
4 points for Ray, along with 4 rebounds, 4 assists. While that goes against Delaware, it's going to be on Lane. That's going to be his 4th. He's going to take a seat.
Yeah, he's their best on the ball defender. Sometimes you get a little handsy without doing that. But in conference play, that will settle down. But I'm impressed with his game, the transfer from Florida.
Weston, high-low, lost the handle of it, was Brown. 16th turnover of this game for Rhode Island.
Here comes Riley, sets a little screen himself, then gets open off of it. Very under control player.
Bounce pass. From Gooley, has to give it off. 5 left on the shot clock. Trent, great vision, can't convert on the finish.
No, he's good inside. He's got a long arms. He finishes around the rim.
Stewart, left nice. Alone for 3.
See, starting with stops. They're down, cut it to 11. I like Stewart just trailing and getting into comfortable into his shot. They got a little size out there on Rhode Island.
Trent posting up short on the turnaround. Davis.
It's good defense there. See, Brown contested him. Didn't even get him, let him sight the target. Had his hand up when he caught it. Therefore, Davis missed that three.
Weston.
Yep.
And an over-the-back call that takes us to a timeout. Delaware, Rhode Island in the Holiday Hoop Fest. Blue Hens behind Barry Davis. Lead by 11, under 7 minutes to play. Point difference for Delaware, 57-46. Blue Hens with the lead. Mentioned that they're on the longest road trip in D1
days.
This year. 38 days continues. Facing Ryder, Princeton, Hampton will be at home finally before going on the road against Hofstra and Campbell.
Yeah, they're going to start the CAA on the road, which, well, I got Hampton at home. Hampton's in the CAA now, too. I really like what I see from this Delaware team. My friend Zach Park, one of the great Delaware Blue Hen fans, also was a manager on their team. He's one of the basketball gurus for legendary three-step organization. Zach Park's watching. He's one of those very celebratory guys, watches them when they win, watches them all the time. Delaware's going to be interesting, their last go-around in the CAA, what it's going to be like.
Well, it'd be interesting, too, and Martin Inglesby, their head coach, made this point. How much different this program would look if you still had Jameer Nelson and Andrew Carr?
But there's a lot of programs that can say
right,
that.
Of course.
And Nelson was the tough one because he was really playing well. I wonder some of these guys that transfer, that's blocked. Timberlake left Towson. He's a starter at Towson, averaging 20 a game. He's getting pro looks. He's coming off the bench in Kansas. The grass is not always greener. And I love Nick Timberlake. I hope he wins a national title. But he's not starting.
Rhode Island's got six left on the shot clock, trailing here by 11. Courtright has to force one up, back ironed it. Ray comes down with the loose rebound. Trent, post up, nice bounce pass to Lane, who's heading to the free throw line.
Yeah, Lane, I like him. He's playing with four fouls, but playing aggressive. And Jameer Nelson Jr., they TCU beat Georgetown by one. It was on a crazy bang shot that probably shouldn't have counted. And Jameer Nelson's doing well down at TCU, playing for Jamie Dixon. It's a different level. You're chartering around, et cetera. But his numbers were better here at Delaware. That's the one thing young men and women, when they transfer, have to worry about. And there's NIL money involved. And some of the smaller schools are now going to figure out ways to get NIL money, and they can play into it. It'll be really interesting to see what Baker does. Charlie Baker's taking over the NCAA because I think it just needs some, I don't mind it, but it needs some guardrails.
I think most people would agree on that.
Now here's a 1-2-2. Now they're not trapping, they're just slowing them down. They match up.
Lob inside, out of bounds. Turnover number 17 for Rhode Island. Still to come, Iona and St. Joseph's in our third and final game. Tobin Anderson looking to take that magic that he had from the run last year with FDU.
He's a really good coach. He was assistant at Siena before I got there. Tobin Anderson, great reputation. What he did at St. Thomas Aquinas is amazing, but he won at Clarkson and at Hamilton. Really, really good Division III head coach.
Of course, if you're just joining us, it was a double overtime win for Bryant, outlasting Towson. Rafael Pinzone, the St. John's transfer, career high 28 points.
And Eton is the transfer from St. Peter's, which is why we've had a lot of this. Tobin Anderson last year, great run. The year before St. Peter's, great run. That's what makes March Madness so great. Delaware's done it a couple years ago. That Bryant team today showed me they're for real in the America East. Phil Martelli Jr. doing a really good job. Scary's just got to work his little magic with this group. Might have to find another scorer. But this is what makes March Madness so great. And today I'm getting to look. I'm really pleased to see how good Bryant was in person, how good Martin Inglesby and Delaware is. St. Joe's, I know from the A-10. I want to see what Tobin Anderson's going to do. But he's going to keep that Iona program, which has an amazingly successful history. He's going to keep it right on track.
Courtright knocks down the free throw, 59-47. Delaware in front. Quiet day for Courtright, just 8 points, six rebounds.
We better grab that. Good hustle. Nope, stepped out.
Davis stepping out of bounds. 11 turnover for Delaware. But again, Davis has been the story today, 22 points. I mean, he had an electric career in high school. First player in Delaware history to earn first team All-State all 4 years, was a two-time state champion, Gatorade Player of the Year, went to Providence, now transferred over back to his home state as Stewart on launching from three. That's his second one of the day.
Yeah, he's good. Stewart's got that top of the key three down. Yeah, Davis to me, we'll talk more about it, but I thought Delaware was under-recruited. I recruited a kid named Laurent Prophet there who played in the NBA. I thought she was from English who played at Iona and let them call their titles played there. Delaware's you drive through, you go to Philly, to Baltimore, to D.C., to Jersey, to all these places to recruit. There's a lot of players there. But I like that Davis has come back and said, okay, I'll come back to my home state. I'll lead us to wins. I'll lead us to titles. But I'm going to get my points. You know why? Because Bill Parcells would say, because that's what he does. Guys that run for 1,000 yards in eighth grade in high school, they do. Davis just knows how to score.
So give me the blueprint then if you're Rhode Island. You've gotten some play here from Stewart off the bench. 8 points, 3 of 3 shooting. You've cut it down to a single point deficit in terms of 59-50. What does Archie Miller have to do to get over the hump here in the final 4:38?
You know, you have to press because you're down 9. Now, you don't have to totally. I worked for Gary Williams. We believed in pressure defense after free throws. We were used to doing it. But it's nice when you fall behind by 9 because you're used to pressing. He's got a deep team. You know, Archie, I'm looking at his, after watching today, and not having Fuchs isn't fair because he's a really good player for him. So hopefully he needs him back. But they got to get good at one really good one thing, whether it's driving the ball, whether it's having depth. I like Stewart making threes, but Estevez has come in here and really played with some heart, really show me some stuff. Maybe you start him like, these 4 minutes are leading into the next 4 games. You got to be ready by the 8-10. You got to have a plan by the time you get to conference play of what you're going to do. And, you know, you've done the ESPN forever and all these Saturday shows with big wigs like Jay Williams and Seth Greenberg. Just don't tell Seth I said that. But you see these teams, John, that develop a little bit in January and February. You got to have your identity by January and February ready to go. That's if I'm concerned with Rhode Island. What are you trying to do here? Archie's really this Dwayne Woodward up, who's a great player. Boston College is a good assistant. It's not just getting players. It's what do you want them to do? Now, they're coming out in a little zone. It's like a 2-3 stack. But, like, I want to press if I'm down. That's just too easy. And there it is, Ray, second effort again.
Ray, second chance points. It's been a difference maker for Delaware tonight. 11 second chance points and a turnover on the other end for Rhode Island.
So now you're down 11 and you get telling your team to get back and drop back into his zone. Maybe that's, they thought they could get him to miss, but they just scored. So this is an interesting time for Rhode Island. I wish Archie Miller the best. I know it's a rabid fan base in a good and bad way, but you got to decide who you want to play and how you're going to play if I'm watching Rhode Island.
Well, the talent certainly is there. It's just a matter of developing that talent, whether it be Fuchs or Courtright. Davis fouls up his own miss. 24 points, four away from matching his career high. Stewart traveled with the basketball. That is now 19 turnovers for Rhode Island, and they're starting to see their opportunities and their chances slip away. Delaware, 63-50 lead. Timeout here in Long Island. Delaware with a 63-50 lead on Rhode Island. Second game of our triple header here on Flo Hoop for the Holiday Hoop Fest from inside UBS Arena in Elmont, New York. John Brickley and Jimmy Patsos and Rhode Island just before the break committed their 19th turnover. That ties their season high. Also at 19 against Fairfield. More questions right now than answers for Archie Miller's team.
Yeah, and Archie's going to get this right. Fuchs, you got to have back. You got to win your games. The good news is they play well at the Ryan Center, which is great crowds. And then you just got to figure out how we're going to get some road wins here. Now they're back to tough man-to-man here. Like I said, Stewart showed me something by hitting threes. I can't say enough about Estevez. He's been great with his energy. He had 15 before.
Davis. Off the foul by the junior, Brown.
Yeah, I'm not sure he fouled him either. I'm not sure Brown fouled him there, but, Davis is going to get his share of the calls because he's a really good player. Watch the replay. But it's this 50 points by Rhode Island that's the problem today. The first game, they kept it a little closer. Bryant, and then they were able to press, turn it around the last 2 minutes and come back. Rhode Island, now they're getting ready against their press offense because Delaware is going to do a 1-2-1-1 just to slow them down.
Davis, the number one scorer this year for Delaware, came in averaging 18 a game. Tonight, 26, two away from matching his career high. I thought the biggest note for him was when he first started his career, reached double figures in one of the first 17 games. Since then, 51 of 56 games he has reached double figures in. Courtright at the point. Forced to post up and tough shot. Falls down for the junior transfer.
That's the other thing. You know, Archie Miller's team's going to get older. You know, he's got a younger team. He's got some guys that, you know, they're going to stick around and get better because everyone gets better under Archie Miller. Archie Miller, what a player at NC State, by the way. What a player for Herm Sendek. You know, Estevez is a freshman. Brown's a junior. Fumani's a redshirt freshman. You know, you go down this list. Fuchs is a freshman. You know, they're going about it the young way. And as you just said earlier, that's young versus old. That's usually going to, older is going to usually win.
I'll tell you, I can't tell you how many times I have seen Trent post up. It's just post up situation as a guard.
He had to be playing. He must have went to a smaller school because I didn't know where he came from, went to school in Baltimore. I didn't see him when I was down there. He must have played center in high school or junior high or something. Obviously, has gotten, look at that. That's great footwork. I don't know if he's messing around before practice. He's just got great footwork in there. And he's going to take advantage of it until they double team or stop him. You saw Brian earlier. They were double teaming the post. They weren't going to get beat in the post by Towson. If you're going to let Trent post up like that, and he's tall and long and rangy. He's not some 6'2 guard. He's 6'6. You know, but I just love his game. But this Delaware team, the depth and versatility is the first thing I'll say that comes to mind when I see Delaware.
Mills Lane falling out for Delaware, but to your point about Trent, had his most impactful game against Xavier. Career high 27 points, 10 of 16 shooting, and if you're Martin Inglesby, I mean, there's a chance, more likely than not, unless URI makes some kind of run in the last 206. I mean, you've owned the Miller brothers this year. You took down
Sean.
That's
rare. Let me tell you, that's rare. Sean and Archie, both great players, both great coaches, both great competitors. That's rare to beat both those guys in the same year. No Christmas in Pittsburgh with the Miller family for our friend from Delaware over there. I love Martin Inglesby. He's a funnier guy than you know. He doesn't show it, but he's a good sense of humor, good dude. Really did an amazing job for Mike Bray.
I remember from his playing days.
Oh, yeah.
Well, he was an effective player.
Very good. Oh, very good player.
See, I'm getting to that age, Coach, where I remember the good old days, and now I'm starting to talk about the good old days.
Well, Notre Dame lost to Georgetown today, so those were the good old days at Notre Dame.
Under 2 minutes to go. Delaware up by 13. Out of bounds. Stays with the Blue Hens with four on the shot clock. Riley, that one partially blocked by Estevez. And again, if there is a, I don't want to say a silver lining, but if there is any positive you can take away, it's the fact that Cam Estevez has certainly put himself into contention for being an all-around strong player for Rhode Island this year.
Yeah, they got a lot of young guys, too. I mean, look, I'm a positive guy.
It's going to be a shot clock violation.
They're going to check it.
I didn't think he got the shot off in time.
It was 2 seconds. It was close, but it was a nice move. I had it good. The fans are asking me what I thought it was good, but the referees.
I thought he just missed getting it off. Awesome.
I thought it was good.
Shot clock violation with the call on the floor. They're going to review whether or not the shot clock was beat. To note about the Coastal this year, and we saw early Towson fall in double overtime to Bryant, but, I mean, Delaware's got the notable win over Xavier. First time they've ever beaten a Big East opponent. Then you've got UNC Wilmington took down Kentucky, and let's not forget Drexel defeated Villanova.
Yes,
so they've got some notable wins this year.
Drexel beat Villanova. Violation, we got it.
Shot clock violation, so that'll be a turnover. 12th of the day for Delaware. Stewart trying to work it inside, taken away by Ray as we approach the final minute of this game. It's a strong Delaware team, Coach. The contingent that made it from the 302 all the way up. Drumgooley. As Stewart pushes ahead to Estevez. Put Estevez to the line, chance to set a career high today. Estevez, who had 15 against Northwestern in the Hall of Fame Tip-Off Classic at Mohegan Sun Arena in Uncasville, Connecticut. Here a new career high, 16 points. Delaware with the victory is going to improve to 8-3 on the season. Rhode Island is going to fall to 5-6. Davis, the star of this game, 26 points, too shy of matching his career high as Riley couldn't put a bow on it with the three. Estevez quickly the other way, and that will do it. Delaware, 67, Rhode Island 56, the Blue Ends get the victory and continue to build upon this non-conference schedule. 26 points for Davis. Lane with 10. Jalen Trent also contributed 12 points in the victory. Cam Estevez for Rhode Island setting a career high with 17 points in the loss as Rhode Island will now head back home for three straight games before they open up conference play in the Atlantic 10 against St. Joseph's. Jair Davis, impressive performance, 26 points, 10 of 15 shooting, 3 of 5 from 3. And he is standing by with our Jimmy Patsos.
What a fantastic game. Two away from your career high. You continue to score. Here's what I love about your game. Whether it's inside or out, you'll take the matchups. You had a lot of threes today.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely try to take the matchup that gives me. I put a lot of work in, try to believe in myself. My teammates believe in me as well.
Your team is versatile. They seem to be able to, a lot of guys do different things, including Trent, who kind of is a post-up guard. Yeah. You step up. Tell us how this team's evolved into an 8-3 team.
I mean, really just keep fighting every day, every game. You know, we had a lot of games that we kind of felt like we could have won out of those three losses. You know, it kind of bites at us every day. You know, we try to just make sure we have a complete game.
And lastly, I think the Coastal's wide open this year. You won it 2 years ago. Do you see this team evolving into that?
Absolutely. I definitely think it's a team that, you know, we can go get it done.
Thanks for coming out. You played great today, John. We're back to you. Really good game. Really good game.
Gary Davis, who had 17 of his 26 in the second half, helping Delaware to a 67-56 victory. Still to come on Flo Hoops. We've got the matchup of Iona and St. Joseph's. For Jimmy Patsos and our entire hardworking crew, I'm John Brickley. Back in 20 minutes for our third and final game as Delaware pulls it off against Rhode Island, 67-56.